Linda was born on March 30th, 1952, in Bryson City. She was the wife of the late Wayne W. Keener and a daughter to the late Ralph William Southards and Edith Ellen Waldroup Southards. She was also preceded in death by her brother Buddy Southards and her great grandson Rick. Linda was a longtime member of Sawmill Hill Freewill Baptist Church and a life member of the VFW Post 921 Lady Auxiliary. Those left to cherish her memory are her son Michael Keener of Bryson City, grandchildren Johnny Woodard, Miranda Nations, great grandchildren Oakland, Kamden, Ryder, and Rowdy, sister Wanda Barker of Whittier, brother Larry Southards of Cumming, Georgia, special niece Ashley Barker, special great nieces Shelby Kirkland, Ceana Barker, Atlas Barker, and many nieces and nephews, cousins, and friends. Sister Linda had called, had sent word by Teresa that she needed to see me. And I already know what it was about. She had told me a long time before what her intentions was. And, so me and my wife made our journey to Waynesville, and we visited with Sister Linda, and we talked with her, and she was set in the way things was going to be done. That's Sister Linda, amen. Had a chance to talk to Sister Linda the day before she passed, and I'm so thankful that I did. So thankful that I did. Where's Michael at? Sam, but that's where you said you'd be, brother. Yeah, I didn't care where his daddy always was. Michael went out to put her bird feeder up outside the window and left me and her in there together. And she couldn't talk very well. She could whisper to me. And we talked, and she was very happy about a few things that had happened in the past several months, and she shared that with me. But what I want to share with you is, I asked Linda a question. You're probably thinking, you probably asked her if she was saved. No, I didn't ask her if she was saved. No, the fruit she bared told me she was saved from the beginning that I ever met with Sister Linda. You'll have to forgive me because this tires me up. I said, Sister Linda, I said, me and you've always been close. She's always, when I was here at Sawmill Hill, I'll say, Percy, I'll say the same thing. When we was here, she took care of me. She went out of her way to make sure that everything was taken care of for me, that I didn't have to worry about anything in the office or anything like that. I never had to worry about it. Sister Ruthie and Linda both, I mean, they did a fantastic job on that. And all that worked in there with Sister Linda, they could tell you all about it. But I asked Sister Linda, I says, I'm going to ask you a weird question. But I said, I want to know something. I said, you be truthful to me, Sister Linda. She nodded her head. I said, Sister, I said, how does it feel to know that you are getting ready to leave this world to go home and be with the Lord? I said, how does that make you feel? I mean, I'm curious, okay? Anything wrong with being curious, is it? I like to know what's going through somebody's mind after the last few days of their life. So I'm going to experience it one day myself. Probably, you know what I'm saying? Sister Linda, she lay there, her chest was hurting. And she would touch her chest. But she looked over at me, and she had about a half smile on her face. And I know what that smile was. She said, I'm gonna get to go see my grandparents. Wayne, Mama, Daddy. She said, I'm gonna get to see them all. I said, and Jesus too? She said, yes, and Jesus. But she was just whispering to me. And so that began to weigh on my mind. What would we do if we know we had 2 days left? We had 1 day left. What would we do differently? I hope you can put a smile on your face like Sister Linda did. No. So after our visit and everything, we had a good visit. And when I left, I began to pray and ask God, God, what am I going to say? What am I going to do? And before I got home, oh Lord, God had already put some scripture on my heart. And so I have stuck with that. I've learned not to change God's will. Because when you go changing God's will, I tell you what, you get in trouble. Amen? Somebody say amen. So, I'm in the book of Joshua, chapter 14, and you're going to say, well, what in the world has this got to do with a funeral? Well, I've never preached at a funeral. Never come to my mind about a funeral, but God put this on my heart. And it's about Caleb. And it says, as verse 6 of chapter 14 says, then the children of Judah came unto Joshua and to Gilgal, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh the Kenizzite, said unto him, thou knowest the thing that the Lord said unto Moses, the man of God, concerning me and thee in Kadesh Barnea. 40 years old was I when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to inspy out the land. And I brought him word again, as it was in my heart. Well, after this conversation, I began to realize what God was trying to tell me. I want you to realize there's only one true interpretation of each scripture in the Bible. Everybody agree? One true interpretation, but there's many applications. And what I'm going to give you today is a little application of this verse of scripture, through here, these verses of scripture. Verse 7 there, what I just said, it says, and I brought him word again as it was in my heart. You know, I think that Linda was thinking about something. I think she was thinking about the land that flowed with milk and honey, the promised land. She was beginning to think about that. And you see, Caleb here, he said, thou knowest the thing that the Lord said unto Moses, the man of God, concerning me. This had come back to Caleb's mind. Caleb had been wandering, Joseph and the children of Israel, through the desert for 40-some years. They ain't getting nowhere. They done been there once, okay? And they was ready to take the land that flowed with milk and honey. Two of the spies, which was Caleb and Joshua, had full faith in God, full faith, and said, we can take them. The other 10, their faith was very little. And they said, no, we can't. We're as grasshoppers in their eyes. We can't do it. Caleb said, we can do it. Reason with them. We can do it. We can do it. No, we can't. So the majority won. Are you with me? They're back on their journey again. Well, they come back through. And it comes back to Caleb's mind again. You know, he said, God told Moses that every inch of land that my feet trotted over will be mine inheritance. And you know what? He says, I am 85 years old. That's 85 year old. He said, I am as strong as I was when I was 45 year old. He said, and I am ready to take my land. I'm ready to take my inheritance. And the story goes on. He got his inheritance. Every inch of ground that he walked across, he got it. It took a while. They had to go through a long journey to get there. But Caleb and Joseph, they was the only two left out of the whole generation that was left. that was there the first time. And there, he said, I want it. I'm tired of this. I'm tired of this. And I thought about Sister Lynn. When she was able, hey, I'm telling you, she didn't miss church. She didn't miss church. When she got to where she couldn't walk blood, she brought her walker. She was on the walker when I left here. She's like Caleb. Caleb followed the Lord. That's why he didn't die in that trip in the wilderness. That's why him and Joseph didn't die, because they was true to God. So, I believe with all my heart that Linda was thinking a whole lot about where she was wanting to go. Don't you think, church, that we get tired? You've seen people battling with cancer and other things, and you say, how can they give up? How can they give up? Well, I want to tell you something. You should never say that until you're in their shoes. We don't know what people go through. I know God said he'd never put no more on us than what we could bear. But I believe that God was with Linda every bit of the way. Even all the days that she laid in that bed and she couldn't get up and move or walk. Our God, our Jesus, was still right there with her. And she come to that point in her life where she said, I'm ready to go home. I'm ready to claim my inheritance. I'm ready. I followed the Lord. I've done what the Lord's wanted me to do. And I'm ready to take it. That morning around 4 o'clock or so, she stepped into that promised land. She had the victory, church. Her suffering, her pain, her agony, it was over. She was cured. I watched the thing here, Sister Linda, from the time she was young until the latter part of her life here. And I said, she was a beautiful woman when she was a young woman. Was she not? She was a beautiful woman. I had never seen no pictures of Linda when she was young. And it kind of just set me back at all. And but you know what was the most beautiful thing about Linda? That old heart. That old heart. She had love. She had love in that heart. If your heart don't have that love, you need a little bit more of Jesus. Because Jesus can put that love in your heart that nobody else can take away from you. We need to trust him more than we ever have. And we see the end times winding up. I believe it is. I don't know about you. I know that John in the Bible, he thought time was about up. It might last another million years. Who knows? But I do know one thing. Ever how much longer it does last, I will be with God. I think Linda, she was ready to leave. She made her peace with everyone. And I think that's some of the greatest things that can be done, to make you peace. Make sure you tell everybody you love them. And you see them again when they make it to that promised land. Linda was tired. But you know what? She ain't tired no more. She ain't tired no more. How many can picture her right now in heaven? Back in, I think, in the prime of her life, maybe. I don't know. But I don't think she's walking around with a walker. I really don't. I think it's all over. All that old past stuff's over. And life has just begun. Linda was a wonderful lady. I will always remember her. I will always love her in my heart. And what I want to do is rejoice in her new life. Because she deserves it. She deserves her new life. I thank God that he looks down upon us and he has mercy upon us. I thank God that when we cry out to him to save our souls, we repent of our sins, he'll save us. Thank you. Caleb, he did inherit that land. Just like God told Moses. He inherited. when Linda got saved. I don't know how old Linda was when she got saved. Does anybody?
She's young.
She was very young. You remember what it felt like when God saved you? Did you fear death? No, because we know we're saved and we're in God's hands. She got back to that same place again. I think she had that same faith from the day that the Lord saved her soul until the day that she left here. She knew that God had her. She knew that nobody was going to pluck her out of God's hands. And I think she left here a happy woman. I really did. Preacher, how can you say that? She died. Let me tell you what. There's more to life than right here. There's way more to life than right here. There's things up here in heaven that our eyes ain't never seen. Our ears ain't never heard. The joy that's going to be in heaven when we get there. So church, get prepared. Church, get ready to meet Jesus. He's coming. Don't wait too late. That's all I'm going to say. Except for, I love Sister.
Amen.
I love her. Father God, I want to thank you. Just for letting me say a few words this morning, God, for Sister Linda on her behalf, God. She loved everybody, Lord. She was a good person, Lord. And I know her family's going to miss her, Lord, something terribly, Lord. God, just be with them, Lord, and help them in the days to come, God. Father, we praise you for all. Lord, I ask you just to bless the remainder of the service, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
reminisce just a little bit. Back in 1980, this is where I got my start in pastoring. I came here from Nashville, Tennessee out of college, and a lot of people have gone on. I was sitting here thinking, while they were singing that song, the first funeral that I ever preached, and some of you might know this guy, his name was Rufus King. Any of y'all know him? Remember him? Way back young. I was scared to death. I had never preached a funeral before, didn't know what I was doing. And some of y'all might think I don't know what I'm doing now. I don't know. But we go back a long ways. That's been, 44 years. And I've been preaching, and I've preached a lot of funerals. Some people I knew, some I did not know. And the kind of work really in you, called on to do things that sometimes somebody dies, they don't have a pastor, they call you to preach the funeral, you go preach the funeral. But a lot of things have happened in these last 44 years. Some were good, some were bad. But one thing I've learned in life is this: if you believe in the sovereignty of God, and I do believe in the sovereignty of God, that He's not only sovereign in the good times, He's also sovereign in the bad times.
Amen.
Always. God never changes. He is who He is. But a lot of memories in this church. I can remember when we didn't have air conditioner. Y'all guys remember that? Y'all remember that? You folks got fine limbs now. I remember when I started out, the preacher's supposed to wear a coat and tie. I haven't wore a tie in 15 years. Maybe once or twice. But I remember preaching, moving around, shouting and hollering and carrying on up here in a suit and tie. And you get through, you'd be wet with sweat. I mean, these folks like to work me to death. But it's been a lot of good times. And one of those good times was the people who came into this church and got saved when I was here.
Amen, brother.
I remember people like, well, German Vogel was here, got the owner back there, and just so many people. And I cannot not mention Linda. Linda was one of those people that came. In fact, Wanda, you and Rodney used to come sit right over there. Just so many. I mean, I can in my mind picture where people sat when I was a pastor. I can tell you who was in church and who was not in church, because you folks are preacher habit. You sit the same place every Sunday. That makes it kind of easy on the preacher. And the preacher knows. But Linda was a good friend of mine. And I'm not just saying that. Most of us don't have a lot of friends. I had a fellow say to me one day, he said, if you got five friends, you're blessed. Linda was the kind of friend for me that I didn't have to talk to her every day. In fact, I didn't have to talk to her every year. But when we did talk, it was like we'd been talking all the time.
Yep. Amen.
I guess it's been, three or four weeks ago, Therese and Twinkle and me, we went over to the nursing home there in Waynesville to just see Linda. We walked in there, and she was glad to see me. I'm glad to see her. And we stood there and sang, I don't know, three or four, five songs. Songs we all know. What a day that will be. We're never grow. Amazing grace. And it just blessed her, and it blessed me. I don't say a lot of things when I preach funerals now. I don't put people in heaven, because that's not my job. And I don't put people in hell. But sometimes you know somebody pretty well. And if Linda loved the Lord, then I have no doubt saying and believing in my heart that she's in heaven.
Amen.
I have no doubt. I mean, I'm okay with that. And sad truth is, a pastor can't say that every time. Because everybody doesn't go to heaven. There's no doubt in my mind I probably preached as many funerals of people who are lost and went to hell as people who are saved and went to heaven. No doubt in my mind. In fact, Jesus said some of those you thought went to heaven, they're not going to be there. And some of those you thought didn't go went. I had this old timer tell me one time, I'm trying to think of his name, Howard, his last name. He said, "Preacher, I had a dream the other night and went to heaven." Or, "I had a dream, I got to heaven and I looked over there and I saw my neighbor who had been kind of a bad guy. And it kind of surprised me that he was there." Then I went on down the street a little further, saw another guy. He said, "I was really surprised that he was there." He said, "Then I walked by this little lake and I saw my reflection and I was surprised I was there." So it's not my job to do that, but my responsibility, and I really have tried to think this thing out about what Linda would want me to say, but it's not important what Linda would want me to say. What's important is what God wants me to say today. Because it's over with as far as Linda's concerned in this life, and I by no means am belittling her because she left a good testimony. She left that. But that part's over with for her. So what I've got to do in the next few moments is to try to help you and on your journey, because all of us are on a journey.
Right.
Every one of us. The greatest tragedy of all tragedies. You know, if you turn on your TV today or back in 9/11 and you saw the planes flying to the towers, that was a great tragedy for the United States of America. Everybody remembers, if you were born during that time, what you were doing when it happened. I remember it. I was sitting on my couch in my home, and I saw it happen, and I thought I was watching a movie, and a few minutes it happened again, and it was a tragedy. Over thousands of people lost their life. That's a tragedy. It's a tragedy when you hear tell of some young person getting killed in a car wreck. That's a tragedy. It's a tragedy when you hear tell of the shootings that we hear about in this great land we call America, in the schools and places of work, when people go in and take lives, innocent lives. I know we all heard about what happened at Joe Osteen's church when somebody went in with a rifle, high-powered rifle, and was going to kill people, and the lady was eventually killed and the little boy was shot. That's a tragedy. And every one of us could stand here today and tell a story of some great tragedy. But let me tell you what the greatest tragedy will be for you and for me. We find this in Matthew chapter 7. One thing I would recommend for you to do is this, is to read the Sermon on the Mount at least twice a week for a year, and it will change the way you live. The Word of God is like that. The Bible says it is powerful, it is sharper than any two-edged sword, and it cuts asunder and it reveals to us who we are. The Word of God is not for God. The Word of God is for you and me.
Right.
And the greatest tragedy of all tragedies will be for you to die thinking you were saved and get there and find out you're lost. The church has messed up so much stuff. We tell people they got to do this and they got to do that in order to be saved. Every church has its little rules. We need to forget about the rules of the church and think about the rules of God.
Amen, brother.
And I'm not saying all those rules are bad. But do you realize that there will be people who've gone to church every Sunday for years? When they stand before God, God will say, "I don't know who you are." That's a tragedy. That man died thinking he was going to heaven, realizing when he gets there he can't go to heaven because the Father does not know him. And the reason why the Father does not know him is because he did not know the Son. You see, we can't get to heaven unless we go through the Son.
Amen, brother.
We can't. You see, it's going to be a tragedy for some preachers who have preached the Word of God for 30 and 40 and 50 years. And they stand before the Father and the Father says, "I don't know you." And they say, "But Father, I preached and I warned people and I saw people get saved and get born again." And God's going to say, "I don't know you because my Son doesn't know you. And the reason my Son doesn't know you is because you don't know my Son."
Amen, brother.
It's a tragedy. And so, I don't believe people in heaven knows what we're doing. Now, you might think they do. If you do, you show me that biblically and I'll go along with you. Couldn't be happening if people in heaven knew what we were doing. I told someone the other day, I said, if my daddy knew what I had done since he'd gotten saved, since he died, if he knew everything I'd done, he'd ask God to let him come back and take care of business.
Yep.
So he'd beat the devil out of me. One time he was spanking me, I remember hearing him saying, if I could beat the devil out of you, I would, but you got too much of him in you. Something like the rest of you. But there will be people there. And so my responsibility today is this. You see, you don't get saved by walking in front of a church and repeating a little prayer and shaking the preacher's hand and joining the church and getting baptized. There will be multitudes of people that got baptized in this river back here that died lost because they didn't know God. The reason why they didn't know God is because they didn't know the Son.
Amen.
Right, bro.
So what would we do today? What does God want you to know? He wants you to know what he's always wanted you to know. And that is how to get to heaven. And so for the next few minutes, and I'm not going to take a long time. You see, I don't care if you're a member of Cherokee Baptist Church or Sawmill Hill Freewill Baptist Church. When we get to heaven, he's not going to say, bring up the rolls of Sawmill Hill.
Come
on, brother. He's not asking about them rolls. You better make sure your name's written in the Lamb's book of life. And once it gets put there, don't you worry about it. God's able to keep it there. Let's just read a little bit of the Bible. I like the Bible. You folks like the Bible? I'm going to show you how and what you got to do to go to heaven. Say, preacher, I'm a good man. No, you're not. You got a depraved heart. We don't like to think about depravity. By depravity, I mean this. You're capable of doing anything. You're capable of committing any sin apart from God. If God was not in our lives, we could do anything that the flesh wanted to do. And the greatest battle you fight is not between you and me. The greatest battle you fight and I fight is the battle within ourselves.
That's right, brother.
Called the flesh. See, since I've gotten saved, and I got saved a long time ago, I've been carrying around a dummy. It's called the flesh. And I tell you, he gets heavier and heavier and heavier. He's there. He tempts me. You won't believe this, preacher. Tempts me to say things sometimes I shouldn't say. Is anybody else in that category?
Amen.
You ever stump your toe at 2 o'clock in the morning? Said enough. You ever had somebody pull out in front of you in traffic? And you give them that hallelujah wave. I mean, I'm just telling you like it is. I know you. You know how I know you? Because you're just like me. Here's the deal. Jesus said there'll be some there who said, look, I prophesied in your name. I cast out demons in your name. I preached in your name. I went to church in your name. I tithed in your name. And by the way, God doesn't need your money. But I'll tell you what he'll do. If he gets your heart, he'll get your money.
Yeah. Right, bro.
That's the way it works. Well, let me get on here. Because I know we got, man, it's time for fleeing. The first thing the Bible tells us is this, in order to be saved. The Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verse 10, and the scriptures say this, no one is righteous, no, not one. Secondly, the scriptures say this, for everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. And so what's he saying there? He said, we're all sinners. I don't think I got to stand here and prove to you today that you are a sinner. I think you already know that, right?
Amen, brother.
Most of us do. Then the Bible says, but God, he has showed us his great love. How did he show us his great love? He showed us his great love by sending Christ to do what? To die for us while we were yet sinners. God is just magnificent. He's amazing.
Amen.
There's two times in the Bible when you'll see this phrase. Holy, holy, holy. Two times. And each time it was said, it wasn't said by man. It was said by heavenly angels.
Right.
You see, God is a holy God. The angels in heaven sing about his holiness. Holy, holy, holy. And in the book of Revelation, that's when Hezekiah, King Hezekiah. Then you go to the book of Revelation, and the angels, when they see Jesus and they see God, they cry out, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. He is such a holy God.
Amen, brother.
The Bible says that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all.
Right.
The only way you and I can stand in the presence of God is to have the blood of Jesus Christ applied to our lives, our sins washed away, and God declares that we're holy because of the holiness of his Son. If he sees anything about you and me, we're lost.
Right, brother.
He's got to see the Son.
Amen.
The Son. For all have sinned, he said, and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. The Bible says that men love darkness. Why? Because their deeds are evil. They got a depraved heart. The Bible says that the heart is deceitful above all things. The heart is deceitful above all things. It will lie to you. And desperately wicked. Apart from God. God is light. And in him is no darkness at all. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Amen.
The Bible says in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Wages. Let me tell you something. You don't want to pay for your sins. If you pay for your sins, you'll be paying for your sins forever and ever and ever. Hell is bad. Hell is really bad. I cannot depict for you and paint for you a picture of just how horrible hell is going to be. But I guarantee you there have been people since we've been preaching this sermon that have gone to hell, and they're going to be there forever and ever, not because God wanted them to go, because the Lord is not slack concerning his promises. Some men slack count slackness, but his long-suffering to us were not whether that any of us should perish, but that all of us should come to repentance. See, what does Jesus want you to hear? He wants you to know how to get to heaven. And if you go to heaven, you'll go by the way of the cross.
Right.
Forget about your works and think about what Jesus did. When I stand in his presence, it'll be because of what he did.
Right.
I hear that song sometimes and people sing it, and I guess it's all right they sing it. And I hate to say this, but a lot of the songs they sing are not scriptural, but that's here or yonder. Talk about when we get to heaven, we'll look around and that will be our reward. Let me tell you something. When we get to heaven, we're not going to be concerned about our reward. We're going to be there because of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
And all of that, the multitude after multitude, the soul that's been saved, is to his credit, not my credit. If he allows me to preach, to God be the glory. If he allows me to sing, to God be the glory. If he allows me to share the gospel, to God be the glory. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. That's what it's about.
Amen, brother.
Talk about living a shouting. We can't even imagine what took place. I need to close. So let me just move on and read just a little more of the scriptures. If you openly declare that Jesus is Lord, let me just say this. I need to say this. If you get saved, you don't have to worry about changing. God's going to change you.
Right.
And if you get saved, you're not going to keep living the way you used to live.
That's right.
I'm talking about if you get saved. You see, the problem that we have is we want to keep living the way we used to live. Before we got saved, you can't keep living the way you used to live. You got to listen. Paul said this, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Jesus said, you must deny yourself and take up the cross. Most of us want salvation without a cross. You cannot have salvation without a cross. Here's what it says. If you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God. And it is by openly declaring your faith that you are saved. You want to go to heaven? Stop trying to get there on your own.
Amen.
Stop trying to keep a set of rules. Trust in Jesus to save you. And when he saves you, the Bible says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. And I'll tell you what he'll do. If you give him time, he'll make you into the person that he wants to be. And when you die, not if. Before I took this trip, I'm getting to the age, I'm 67 years old, and I know I'm going to die. Just don't know when. But the way I drive up and down the highway, I do a lot of miles. And all those other people are crazy drivers. And I got to thinking, I need a wheel. How many of you always have thought that? I need a wheel. And so I had a wheel made. You know the reason why I had a wheel made? Because I want to be prepared. I got a wheel in heaven. Jesus says, lay up treasures in heaven. I'm working not for my glory, not for my honor, but for the honor of my Savior.
Amen, brother.
One day, I'm going to get there. I don't worry about dying, really. I'm not afraid. People say, well, you're talking crazy, preacher. No, I'm not. I just know where I'm going.
Amen.
And the only way I can get there is to die. I told the church I pastored one Sunday, I said, I don't understand something. I said, you want to know what I don't understand? My folks talked back to me. They said, yeah, preacher, we'd like to know. I said, I don't understand. My people spend so much money on a body that's going to go back to the dust of the earth. Might be God calling you, but I answer that thing. Him, I got news for you. You're going to live for him. That's what he's going to do. He's not a weak God. He's powerful. And he said, here's what he said. It is my will for every one of you who are my children that you, now listen to how it reads, that you be being conformed into my image. We Christians are to look like Christ in our hearts more and more every day of our lives. If there's anything I saw in Linda's life, I saw this. I saw Jesus.
Amen.
And when I get to heaven, I want God to see Jesus. That guy broke down what I'm supposed to do. We're going to have a song now.
Blessing from the storehouse. prayer. If you want to, you may stand. God, we thank you so much for the life of Linda Keener. For her testimony, Lord, it will always be dear to our hearts. And what you did through her, God, will be a blessing. I pray, Father, that as we preach your word today, that for that person who has made a commitment to you, that you will bless them and that they will follow through with it. Lord, I do pray for the family. God, many of us have been exactly where they're at, and their hearts are heavy. But God, you can walk with them and carry them. And we thank you for that promise. I thank you, Lord, above all things, because God, we are unworthy. I'm so thankful for your Son, Jesus Christ, who saved us, who redeemed us, and who has promised that he's coming again. And our prayer is this, Father, even so, Lord Jesus, come. Amen.
Mr. Lehman, she had it finalized, but Carolyn was going to sing. She loved the Carolina Crossman with all her heart, without a doubt. And you get to do it. Bless your heart.
Thank you.